I would actually now ask all the speakers in this session come to the front so the audience has possibilities to ask questions and have discussions with all the speakers. Okay. So, any questions from the audience? Okay.
Sakari Kuikka from the University of Helsinki. You, Harri, said correctly that shallow bays are important for the fish production, reproduction. I wonder, do you or someone else has some kind of prediction what happens for these vegetation in a case this climatic change happens, that the ice disappears at least to some extent?
Markku, help. Markku Viitas, I'll tell you everything about that.
Sorry, I was tweeting. The question was that do you or someone else have some kind of prediction what happens for the vegetation in the shallow bays, which are important for the reproduction of the fish, and the vegetation, let's say, in 50 centimeter or less is quite important for many species?
Well, of course, if some habitat is completely disappearing due to the land uplifted, then that's gone. But as for the climate change, we expect that the salinity change will probably decline the dominance of hard bottom algae like fucus in the Botnian Sea and Kvarken, and if those will be gone from rocky bottoms, then of course there will be nothing to replace them except for the filamentous algae, especially in Kvarken. You could expect that vascular plants or aquatic plants could take the place of marine algae, but that is not possible in rocky bottoms, because the plants will need anyway soft bottom or some mixed substrate to be able to attach to the bottom. So that's what probably will happen in these hard rocky shores. But as for the embayments, these may experience lower salinity and probably better conditions for some freshwater fish, but probably the fish people could have a better answer for that question.
I'm Mikael Hildén from the Strategic Research Council. Thank you for the presentation. Specifically focus on Antti Kause's conclusion that you say that the movement is towards the open sea in fish farming. Now, it's okay for environmental reasons, but do you see challenges then when it comes to circular economy, which is also the upcoming objective? So the little share of 1% on recirculation system, is that predicted to remain, or is there an ongoing pressure to move back actually from the sea into the recirculation system? Thanks.
Okay, yes, I agree with you. The graph is for global values. And in places where, for example, fish prices are higher, there are more valuable fishes, energy costs would be very low. They are the places where the recirculation systems are, let's say, more potential. In Finland, of course, the percentage is already higher than 1%, and hopefully increasing. And of course, it's something that can be used for recirculating, let's say, nutrients and stuff. Of course, the open sea farming, we have the Baltic Sea feed, which helps in the recirculation system from the feed side. And there are new technologies which are like semi-closed open sea farms, which come closer to the recirculation systems which are at land. So if it's open sea, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's open cage. And there's plenty of technologies developed for this sort of things. So there are things to think and to develop, and of course people are aware of, I mean, the industry is aware of the issues what consumers are worried about.
Yeah. Asking Mikael, what did you mean that it's open sea is better for environment?
The immediate environmental consequences
Hi, I'm Meri Kallasvuo from Luke. I have a question to Harri. Actually, this is a continuation to Sakke's question about the effects in the shallow areas. That I believe that it's quite difficult to divide the effects of climate change and eutrophication, actually, in the shallow areas. To some extent, the effects are quite similar. And I'd like to hear your opinion that should we divide the effects, and also do you believe it is possible to somehow divide them?
Okay. Yes and no, and perhaps. Okay. So, my brains are working now.
Take coffee.
Yeah. So I think climate change is actually enforcing or increasing some effects. And as we saw from Anna's presentation, the natural variability is such that it's actually quite impossible to see in nature. But if we can have good physiological and environmental models, so we can actually predict something and describe it more in more detail. But just finding from field data, it's kind of impossible, and we don't know enough from the physiology of many species at the moment. What is quite clear will be the salinity effect, because it's not related to eutrophication, and it will be a physiological force that is actually quite powerful. But then yes and no, and perhaps on the other parts. We can discuss it later on, I think.
Thanks. Okay, are there more questions?
It's very often cited that precipitation and river runoff will increase and then bring more nutrients to the system, and that will probably cause eutrophication in many of the Baltic seas. Now there is an alternative hypothesis, especially for the Bay of Botnia, from Uppsala researchers in Sweden that have or Umeå researchers in Sweden that says that because more dissolved organic carbon will flow into the Bay of Botnia and perhaps Kvarken, then that will change the system to be more heterotrophic. And the hypothesis, if it's true, might actually make eutrophication smaller, because the bacteria will compete with phytoplankton. And then if this logic goes, then there would be less sedimentation and less organic carbon on the bottom for the benthic animals to feed. What is your opinion, Harry, of these two alternative hypotheses? Which one do you believe, and which way will it go?
Okay, my brains are working again. That's a hypothesis which is a good one to go on, but there's a recent article by Swedish again, because there are plenty of Swedish scientists, it seems, and they are totally different in their view. And they show statistically that dissolved organic carbon and sedimentation to the bottom layers of the Botnian Sea, at least, are linked. So the more dissolved organic carbon you have in the system, the more you have sedimentation and oxygen demand. But I don't know which one is correct. If we wait for the Swedes to fight with themselves, or should we look at that, those hypotheses? I don't know which is better. But anyway, the hypotheses are there. There are a lot more possible routes, and we should probably look at them, because one thing is that the microbial loop-based system is better for animals. It creates more high-quality food, and that will be very important change that has been found in other systems. But that's still open again, and I have only a few years to work before my retirement, so I should go on into that.
Hi, I'm Lari Veneranta from Luke, and just a short note for the eutrophication thing, because I guess there should be two different views for the eutrophication. The eutrophication that happens in the open areas, and the eutrophication that happens in villineers or coastal areas, which are also important for the fish reproduction. So it's all about the thing that is coming from the rivers, and the river load is the most influential thing probably for the near-shore coastal areas, which are quite affected by the many rivers we have. And it's also different in Finland and Sweden. So always when thinking this eutrophication, it's a bit... You have to think what area you are actually thinking. Just a comment. Thanks.
Yes, I have a question to my colleagues in the panel or the local experts. So there was a news in Yle and in many other medias that there was an algae bloom here in the Vasa archipelago. And I think that was for me the first time when I heard about the algae blooms as north as here in Vasa, because I have got the impression that even in the Botnia Sea, the algae blooms are very, very rare. So what do you think, that there was this algae bloom, was it caused by the really warm summer? Temperatures was really high, or was it has there been a steady increase on the nutrients in the area, and now it is just a time when there was a blossom? So was it just by chance, or do you expect this kind of phenomena will be continue in these areas?
Let's wait for the others.
Yes.
Yeah, this was a specific species of Euglena. It actually produced a very red red tide of red water, and that specific species it thrives in shallow bays, and it gets part of its nutrients from the sediment. So it goes around, it can swim better than you, and it goes.
No,
I've seen you swim. Okay, it goes up and downs and gets phosphorus and nutrients, and that was a specific thing. It was very local, but the worrying thing is that it could also be toxic for fish, this species. But you are so young, you don't remember the blooms, of, for example, near Oulu. There was in 70s cyanobacteria blooms, this kind of formidium and others. So things are changing. They are getting better in some places, like in these areas. And then this was, I think, due to very warm summer, because this species also likes warm water.
Okay.
Euglena is, this species is also found in sewage treatment plants and so, such things. Very, very nasty bug. Interesting.
So,
also, cyanobacteria bloom reported.
Yeah, there were cyanobacteria blooms. And the reason for that, for the local experts told that it's actually it's eutrophication. There could be something to do. There was, I think, some of the breakage in the sewage treatment system in city Vaasa, I think, or somewhere, and that could be have affected. But I think Vincent knows better about this.
Yeah.
Okay, just a short answer. I'm Vincent Westbury from the Regional ELY Center, one of the experts, maybe. I don't know. We have had cyanobacteria blooms before, but this time we managed to get to the media with it. So that was nice, of course. In this case, it was Afanitsomen on big areas of blue gene algae coming from the Swedish side. But of course, the sewage treatment problems in the city of Vaasa may have had some implications to the local blooms here. So we've seen it before, but it was maybe quite late this year in beginning of September, end of August. So when the sea temperature is so high in September. My guess is that we will see these kinds of events more in the future. That's a guess.
Okay, the discussion is interesting, but we are closing the coffee break, so I give the last question to...
Okay, thank you. My name is Jaakko Henan from VTT, and I have a question question to Anna and Jari about the ice thicknesses in Kemi. Perhaps I didn't fully understand, but in Anna's presentation, there was a decreasing trend in length of the ice season in Kemi, but then you showed an increasing trend in ice thicknesses. And Jari showed similar pictures with the decreasing trend in ice thicknesses. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, it's not very good that you asked. You know, for Kemi, we have there one of the longest time series. It's more than 100 years old long time series, and we have used that data. You know, just to, you know, analyze and plotting. But because the data has been collected for the not really climate research purposes, the monitoring purposes, it's for the ice service things. So we are not really sure how much the location has changed during the years. So there is no records about the changes in the location. And then when we have analyzed that, this has been like a classical example for us that in other sites there are different trends. So then for this smart sea analysis, we just took the last 50 years, the time period where we know exactly, or the much better understanding about that time series are homogeneous, consistent. We rely on much more that one. this is something that is really uncertain for us, that the, is the trend what we can see in Kemi in 100 years trend, is that real or is that artificial because of the changes in location? And because there are no records about that one. So for ice thickness, if you change the location within the 10 kilometers, you're going to have a quite much of change in ice thickness. And that's problematic in that data set.
So Jari's Marchi analysis is more recent than the results we have from the back book. So if they reanalyze the data, I believe that's more reliable than the little bit older that we used in the back book. Yeah. But I didn't know about your results.
Yes, yes. And you know, I can. It's my own sin. So I was the lead author in the back
so
one
chapter.
And two. Yes, yes. But when I have a look in more details, that we are not confident the data anymore.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you again to all the speakers. Discussions during coffee break, and we will continue by 2:11.